In the past, the bulk of the program budget, the bulk of the operational budget, and almost 90% of the peacekeeping budget has been contributed by external partners. As you are aware, the decision was taken to impose the 0.2% levy, which many countries have started to do, including my own country, Ghana, have started to impose the levy. And as the president of the commission just spoke, he said that more countries have begun to impose the levy. So it means that more resources are going to become available to the African Union to be able to, one, cover as much of its program and operational budgets as possible, but make a commitment to cover up to 25% of all people. That allows the commission to have a greater say on what happens in terms of its programs, its operations, and also in terms of peacekeeping. Of course, that does not mean that there's going to be an end of collaboration with external partners, especially the United Nations. All African countries are members of the United Nations, and we contribute our membership dues to the United Nations.
What are the factors, apart from the money factor, that could define this ownership, this self-reliance that we're talking about?
It is owning it in terms of the fact of bringing up African solutions to African problems. For instance, yesterday I spoke about the experience with the Liberian Civil War and the fact that it was the West African states under the ECOMOG that was the first to intervene. Now, this intervention force had a greater knowledge of the course of the conflict and the terrain. And so it was easy for them, it was much easier for them to go in and stabilize the situation before the United Nations came in. And so I do think that as much as possible, Africa is a continent that has its own cultures, its own traditions, and we understand our cultures and traditions much better than anybody coming from outside. And so if we have a greater control of not only intervening in conflicts, but also in our programs, the programs that the African Union runs on the continent, that we have more control of those programs, then we're able to apply that African knowledge much better than somebody else doing it for us.
The AU is able to finance itself then. What happens to the donor partners? Yes, we want to preserve that relationship, but they also want to have a say, call the shots.
Well, there are issues that are global that we can still collaborate on. For instance, a lot of the discussions that have taken place yesterday here in the Tana Forum had to do with climate change and adaptation. And climate change is something that affects not only the African continent, but affects the entire globe. And so, of course, we're able to collaborate together with our other partners on issues that are global in character. And so there will be those areas in which we continue to have interactions, and we continue to partner each other to find lasting solutions to some of those challenges that face us.
So how do we now solve the new phase of extremism that we are seeing erupting across the continent? Obviously, not the kind of conflict that we knew 50 years back. How do we solve that?
Well, we need to look at the underlying factors and resolve those factors to be able to create a permanent solution to what is happening. As you are aware, there are failed states in North Africa, and I'm talking specifically about Libya. And it is the collapse of Libya as a state that has allowed some of the lawlessness you see in the Sahel region. Also, a lot of weapons that were taken from Libya after the fall of the Gaddafi regime have found their way into the Sahel and into the northern part of the savannah, and is fueling some of the terrorism like Boko Haram, northern Mali, attacks in Burkina Faso, and so on and so forth. But aside from that, we also have the issues of pastoralist families that are displaced as a result of the changing climate pattern. The pastures are shrinking, and so people who used to be able to sustain themselves, either in agriculture or tending cattle, are finding that their lives are getting disrupted. And so they become easy prey for recruiting agencies to draw them into some of these terrorist organizations. Aside from that, the displacement of ISIS in Syria and Iraq is making some of these people find their way into a safe haven, which is the Sahel, and not as regimented by governmental control as one would expect it to be. And so those are some of the factors that are fueling the crisis there. Africa needs the support of the international community to be able to resolve this. Us working together with our Arab brothers, because a lot, the North African countries are a hybrid between Africa and, you know, the Arab world. And so working together with our Arab brothers and indeed other interested partners to see how we can stabilize the situation in North Africa so that we can bring greater control over the Sahel and the Sahara region.
So on democracy in Africa, we're seeing elections coming in more contested now. We are having difficult times transitioning from one leadership to the next. How do we solve this, and especially for the AU, how can they be more effective overseeing that there's that smooth transition that does not lead to violence?
I think so far Africa is not doing badly. Increasingly, we're seeing democratic consolidation on the continent. Just a few decades ago, most of our countries were under military dictatorship or unconstitutional governments. Now you find that the majority of countries are under constitutional governance and hold elections regularly from time to time. This year alone, I'm told that 18 African countries are going into elections, which is a huge number. We didn't used to see this before. Elections by themselves are an expression of the people to participate in how they are governed, to decide who leads them, and that is a good thing. And so in every election, the outcome must be based on expressing the will of the people. And so if that is achieved, then it means that it is positive. But as you know, elections are keenly contested. And of course, everybody wants to win an election, but I guess that we must continue to foster the culture of democracy and let people understand that you can win or you can lose. Winning is part of consolidating democracy, and losing is part of consolidating democracy. The fact that you lose an election does not mean you don't have a role to play. You become the opposition, you must be the watchdog of the people, you must watch over government, make sure that government does the right thing. And so even if you lose, you are part of that democratic process. And until we imbibe that culture, where our people don't see democracy as only winning elections, then we'll continue to have some of these keenly contested elections where people suspect that something has been tampered with, the electronic transmission system has been tampered with, somebody is conspiring to create regime change, and so on and so forth. And so, but I believe that we're making progress.